Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Please come to order. This is the May 21st, 2018 meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I'm Chair Amy Scott Gailey, and all the other commissioners are here and accounted for except for Commissioner Sutton. So we will note that in our minutes. Before we get started tonight, Commissioner Boswell will please lead us in the invocation and Pledge of Allegiance.
Sure will. Spireheads. Thank you, dear Lord, for all our blessings. Thanks for what you do for us each and every day. Lord, as we think about the families out in Texas that are suffering, please put your comforting arms around them. God, just be with us. Let us figure this out, and let's dismiss evil from these schools. Let's work on that. And God, thank you for everything you do for us, and help us to make right decisions as a board tonight. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Join us in the pledge, please. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. We do not have any public speakers signed up tonight for comments. But before we go on from that item on our agenda, I would just remind everybody, I've been in the habit, or the commission has been in the custom the last few months, of reviewing the public comment policy and the rules on decorum at the beginning of each meeting. So I'm going to forego that tonight, since we don't have anybody signed up to speak, except for to remind the public that if you have comments that you wish to submit in writing, that those can be submitted to the clerk of the board, and they will be included in our minutes. Also, if there's anyone in the public who wishes to make a comment and needs accommodation because of some disability or condition, if you let us know ahead of time, we'd be more than happy to try to accommodate that request. Lastly, along those lines, this is an evening meeting, and so we don't have to worry about parking. But at morning meetings, the city of Graham, where these meetings are held, they have started issuing parking tickets. And so just if anybody is watching this on video and thinking about coming to a morning meeting, if you would please remember that you might get a parking ticket, an unwelcome present on your windshield.
Working on the budget.
I got one last.
They have been received. We don't cast aspersions at other people's ways that they try to do things, but that's just something to be aware of. So we had no public speakers, so we don't have any responses. Next on our agenda is approval of the agenda. If everyone has had an opportunity to review the agenda, can we make a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, gentlemen. All in favor of approval of the agenda, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you. Next is the consent agenda. And we have a few items there. When everyone's had an opportunity to review that, if I could have a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right. Next is presentations, recognition of the 2018 Spring County Government Academy. So, Manager Haygood, do you have some information about that program to share with us?
I do. Good evening, Chair and Commissioners. We're here this evening when our first item to take care of is to recognize five participants from the County Government Academy that has just recently completed. These folks with us tonight have completed a 10-week program. They've been very committed, very dedicated to go through this program. They've learned a great deal about county government and the services that we provide. They've had a chance to visit departments, to go to landfill and lots of other interesting places, and meet our employees. And our employees have enjoyed having them as much as I believe they've enjoyed the program too.
A lot going on in the county, isn't it?
Indeed. And they've also had the opportunity to meet some of the commissioners and ask some questions and interact. So we're very pleased to have them here this evening, and we'd like to recognize them at this time. So.
Great, thank you. I think that they wanted all the commissioners to come down for presentations of certificates. And we'll hand them the certificate.
You arrange it.
I guess you go there, and I'll come here. Bunch in a little bit, send you a good picture. Bunch in.
We got a bunch.
All right,
Jeff. Hey,
you're not good, bunch. You are putting the coffee on the outside.
I think you need a better man.
You
look better than me.
Oh, all right. We just want to recognize these folks. This is a real commitment to come out and to participate in this program. I hope that you found it interesting and educational and informative, and we just appreciate y'all having the initiative and commitment to do it. So, Jerry Cummings.
I hope that's me.
That's what you were all the years I've known.
Well, I'm surprised, but thank you very much.
Thank you. Why don't you turn around and we'll take a picture.
Congratulations.
I'll take pictures.
Oh, very good.
Do I hold it up like
yeah.
this?
Yeah.
Very nice.
Thank you. All right, Howard Hayes.
Some of us are running for office. We need to take a picture of me
again.
Thank you. Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you. Why don't
you slip right in the middle between them? Samantha Lloyd. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chair Gailey, I know our clerk, Tori Frank, is not with us this evening, but I would like to thank her for all her efforts she put into the class. I think she does an awesome job kind of making sure that this program comes off and everything works. And I know you folks appreciated her efforts too, and I certainly do. So thank you, Tori.
Yes, she does do a great job with that. Thank you so much. All right, Dr. Todd Thorpe with Lottery Fund Debt Service Application.
Good evening.
Good evening. How you doing?
I'm wonderful. How about y'all?
Good.
A little warm in here right now, but that's...
We're cutting back on air.
Cutting back on air a little bit. Same little... I understand completely. No, I was chasing 2 grandbabies before I came, so you know
that
that's...
It does make a difference.
It does. It does. It's a little different than what I normally do. I do bring 2 requests for you today. One is a lottery fund debt service for about $450,000 that we use every year for debt services for the CTEC Center. And a, let me group the lottery funds together. Okay, and a lottery fund request of a little over $1.1 million to do roofs, the carpet, the tile, and a water tap at Western Middle School.
Well, let's see. I think we have 3 votes that are required. So let's take the lottery fund debt service application first. That's the first action item. This is a request of $450,000+. That's in line with the county's capital finance plan for CTEC.
And just for public information, that's routine. I mean, we have to spend where we're allowed to spend those lottery funds on paying off that.
On capital.
And that's what we've been doing. So I would make that motion.
I'll second that.
All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Next is the capital funds request to use lottery funds. I think this is two motions in one item. First is to use the lottery funds, and then the lottery funds requested, and then the capital reserve funds requested. That's on the second page of the pack agenda item for that. So do you have anything to tell the board about
that? No, ma'am.
I'm just
here for questions, if anybody has any questions.
Well, I notice on here that this includes the Cummings High School roof for almost $850,000, and then the Southern High School roof for another $60,000. And then that's the first motion to use the lottery funds for that. And then the second would be for the capital reserve funds requested. That would be the Cummings roof repair and engineering, and then the Broadview roof repair and engineering.
Correct. There's actually three buildings. There's two sites, but there's three buildings. You got Cummings, you got Cummings Fine Arts, and you have Broadview.
I'll make the motion. We approve that.
Thank you.
This is, we're doing both of these at once, or?
We're doing the, to use the lottery funds is the first motion. So would that be a motion to use the lottery funds?
So in addition to those roofs, it's also flooring at three schools, elementary schools, and
yes, and water tap
at Western Middle.
Western Middle.
Right.
Correct.
So now all that adds up to over $1.1 million.
Yes, sir.
I'll second the motion.
Okay.
That's good.
Right. Is there any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? And then the capital reserve funds requested, as I just said, the roof repair and engineering for Cummings and Broadview.
Well, Ty, why is the Broadview so much more? What's the?
It's just that the square footage of the building plus the amount of damage that's done. We got to take out most, if not all, the insulation under the TPO. So that's going to be, yes, it's just a very expensive process.
Sounds like
it. Is that a membrane roof?
It's a TPO roof.
Okay.
We've put bids out for TPO and PVC. We've been told PVC is a better roof, but it comes with a price tag. But I want to see what that price tag looks like.
Yeah.
So after this, these things are taken care of, does that kind of take care of the roof situation?
Until we get bids in, it will give us a good start. It's where we think we need to be. But when bids come in, it could fool us one way or the other.
But as far as other roofs, I think.
As far as other roofs, we still have Grand Middle School, Sellers Gun, and Holt that we'll be addressing. They're just much smaller repairs. And right now the temporary repairs we have held. So they will be a project a little bit later. These are the two sites that we had to get started this summer. We'll be mid-file finishing, but we had to get those started because of the amount of membrane that's got to come off.
Boy, it's going to be a tough time on that roof in the summertime.
Yes, sir. I'm glad I'm not doing it.
That's
and hopefully the rain will give them a break here. So.
I have a question for Susan or Brian. So after we allocate these funds, how much balance is left in both the school capital reserve fund and the balance in the lottery fund?
Let's see. Here. Yes. For the school's capital reserve fund, we'll have a balance of $6,898.25.
So it's just about wiped out.
Just about wiped out. However, there will be another allocation transferred over for fiscal year 17-18 once we have reconciled our books and sales tax has been collected for June. We'll receive that in August and we'll make that transfer at that point in time. And then for the lottery funds, the balance will be $1.1 million. That does not include the debt service that you approved earlier, so that would bring that balance down to about $713,000.
And these projects are all in line with our capital plan that we put together. Worked very closely with Todd and his folks to make sure that all of this has been coordinated. So this is the process, and these are all proper and right by our books.
Great. Do we have a motion?
I don't believe we do on this.
I'll make the motion.
All right. I'll second that bill.
Awesome. We have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Right, next, we have the Kernodle and Rudd Street properties request. Mr. Haygood.
Well, commissioners, I do have a request here to dispose of two of our buildings. We've been working on our county facility plan. We've retained Clark, Patterson, and Lee, the firm, to help us work on this plan. One of the first priorities, if you'll remember, was for us to make some decisions about some of the vacant properties that we have in our inventory currently. Clark, Patterson, and Lee have looked at two of our three vacant properties. We have three properties that are open, three buildings that are open. They've looked at two of them. These two include the Kernodle building over on Graham Hopedale Road and the Rudd Street building that's located at 405 Rudd Street behind the Human Service Center. Both of these buildings have been vacant for multiple years, and they have both deteriorated pretty significantly. In 2015, we had a report done that estimated the cost to entirely renovate Kernodle, to renovate the entire property, was about $3.3 million, and that was going to leave about 13,000 square feet in shell. So it's a significant cost to renovate that property. We did have some recent estimates from Clark, Patterson, and Lee to what it might would cost to renovate the Rudd Street property. And the estimate was $716,300. That did not include any IT work or any kind of building security. The Clark, Patterson, and Lee folks have looked at both buildings and have made recommendations for both. The recommendations are that the county would be better off demolishing both of these buildings. And if we need space to look at new construction or some other location than these two. However, the recommendation, and I do agree with this, is we should retain the land that the buildings are on until we get through our planning process and make a decision about, do we need these properties? Both are either adjacent or very close to county-owned properties. So until we can figure out the best use for the land, we would retain ownership of the properties. What I would suggest is that we use funds that we have designated from the sale of the Peak building over off of the interstate to do these demolitions. The total amount available from the Peak sale is $3,471,970. In 2015, we had an estimate to demolish the Kernodle building that and to abate any hazardous materials in the building. Asbestos is present in the building. Our estimate at that time was $121,582. We do not have an estimate to demo the Rudd Street building, but that building is only about 5,000 square feet, so it should be significantly less than the $120,000 for Kernodle. Kernodle is around 27,000 square feet, so it's a much larger property. I think we would get a better deal if we put out for bid demolishing both of these properties at the same time. So what I'm here tonight to ask is that the board give us approval to proceed with soliciting bids to demolish both of these properties. And I would return to you if those bids came back in over $50,000, which I'm certain that they would. So I would be back in front of you. And at this time, I'll try to answer any questions. But I do believe this is the right course of action with these buildings. And I believe we should retain ownership of the land until we figure out, through our facility plan process, what do we need to do with them. So I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Do we have asbestos in either one of those buildings?
We know we have asbestos in the Kernodle building. I'm not sure about the Rudd Street building. I don't think we've had them do any testing in there, but we will have to have it tested before we demo. Yes, sir.
Is that Rudd Street building the building that was once the cancer center at County Hospital?
Yes.
So that building should have been built in the like mid-1980s or so?
Yes.
And so probably
maybe not asbestos.
Yeah, maybe not the asbestos. Yeah.
Yes, that's true. It's possible.
Well, I know that sometimes, oftentimes actually, it's less expensive to demolish and build new and get what you really need and want, as opposed to trying to renovate an old building. And
I believe that is the case here. I believe demolishing Rudd Street, it's about 5,000 square feet. I believe we could come back with, if we decided we needed new construction, we could do new construction of that size less than it would take to totally remodel that building. And again, Kernodle, we've had some real issues with the roof. It's been leaking for since we got it. And at this point, we're no longer allowing county personnel into the building. We've had it tested for mold, and it's got the stack mold in the building. So it's off limits to personnel at this point. So I believe we've reached a point where we need to make a decision with what to do with this property.
It's a liability.
They're more liabilities than they are assets at this point.
Yeah.
So I'm asking for the board to consider a motion to give us authority and permission to proceed with getting bids to demo these buildings, and then I would bring the contracts back to the board for approval.
So moved.
I'll second that. Where are we at with the Woody property, the Pete was. We hadn't done anything with that yet.
We've demolished that property, okay, so it's back to pretty much back to grass. We've had several inquiries about the possibility of selling that property. And what we've said is, let us get through this facility plan process again. Let's make sure we don't need it. I don't really foresee us needing that property, but I think it would be wise for us to wait till we get through the facility plan process. And then the board may decide to put it out for sale, open it up for bids, as we've done with other properties before. And what I would hope the board would consider, if we do that, is take any proceeds of that sale and put it toward our facility needs. So.
Well, great. We have a motion and a second. Is there further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Right. Mr. Haygood, I guess you have a recommended budget for us tonight.
Indeed, I do. And at this time, I'd like to distribute copies to the board and to the press also.
Thank you.
I think we have our PowerPoint up. So I've given you hard copies of the PowerPoint that I'm preparing to go through, as well as the budget ordinance. The budget ordinance has lots of details in it, lots of numbers. What I'm going to go over with you is just a good summary of what all is entailed in the budget. So this time we'll begin. And at any point, this is a lot of information to cover, a lot of numbers. If at any point you have questions, don't hesitate to stop me. Myself or Susan will try to answer questions. I would like to take this opportunity to thank Susan and Sherry Hook and Andrea Rollins and Michelle Mills for all the help that they've given me in preparing this budget tonight. This is a lean budget. It is very tight. We have been creative with this budget, and it doesn't do everything that we would like for it to do. I'll be the first one to tell you, but we have tried to squeeze as much as possible out of the county dollars that we're talking about needing. So one thing to start off with is thinking about our vision plan. We will be coming to the board in June with the meat behind the strategic plan. But in the meantime, we still use these pillars to help guide our decisions. And I will just touch a few things about this budget that I'm recommending to you this evening. We have been able to, even though this is a lean budget, do some things for our preserving agriculture pillar. We are including in this budget an additional $50,000 for the preservation of farmland. That would take the total dollar amount available for preservation of farmland up to $100,000. World-class education. I will tell you, we have done a lot on the capital side of the house this year. We have done a lot of work through our Davenport plan and planning process, and what you just did here this evening with Dr. Thorpe approving those projects. This budget continues to support our capital responsibilities with ABSS. And also from the public health and safety standpoint, which you're going to see, and I'll talk about some of the work that we have done in this budget to try to address our high turnover, particularly in our emergency service divisions. I'm going to touch on that. But those are all important pillars of county government. So the recommended budget that I'm presenting you this evening, the total budget is $174,914,946. You can see the breakdown of all of our funds on this chart, on this slide. The one to pay attention to in particular is the general fund, $150,894,043. The remainder of these funds are different sources of income. The main fund we'll be talking about this evening is the general fund. So this evening, when we started off our budget retreat several weeks ago, we had a total dollar amount of requests from county departments, outside agencies, the education system, of over $162 million. The recommended general fund budget that I'm presenting to you this evening is a little over $150 million. On this slide, you can see some breakdown of how those dollars are split up. County government responsibilities total a little over $101 million. The interesting point on this under county government is county services. That's our county departments. So where you see county services, those are all our 25 county departments. And we have held county departments pretty flat. County departments are looking at a 0.3% increase to their overall spending from 17-18. Our debt service payments are up 2.95%, about $282,000. Those debt payments are up due to refunding bonds for ACC and ABSS, as well as the new radios that we purchased this year. So we're up a little bit in our debt service. And then transfer to other funds. You see a tremendous increase here to over 700%. This is where we are now budgeting the school's sales tax funding up front. We have not done that in the past. That's been a tough move to make this year. We're budgeting over $1.8 million up front for school sales tax capital. We must do this. These funds come through sales tax and are required by law to be spent for capital. So we're budgeting them up front this year as opposed to settling up at the end. For education, you see it's a little over $46 million budget for education. It's a 1.56% increase overall. And then our outside agencies, over $3.2 million. You see the 4.31% increase. I want to make sure everybody understands that that increase is primarily coming from pass-through funds, dollars from the state and federal government, or occupancy tax. I'm going to talk about occupancy tax, but our occupancy tax projection is up this year. So county dollar increase here is minimal. For our outside agencies, we're increasing, I'm recommending that we increase the ACTA budget by $23,000. This is, ACTA's moving out into a new facility, and we're going to split the lease payment. That's included in here. And outside agencies, there's also a $2,000 increase for the Forest Service. We're under contract with the state for Forest Service, and their contract price went up $2,000. So it's a very minimal county dollar increase. And you can see on this slide, too, that I'm recommending the property tax rate remain at 58 cents. So we'll talk a little bit about revenue sources. Our property tax revenue, if we remain at a 58 cent property tax rate, and we're projecting a 98.8% collection, which is up, we're projecting a little over $2.2 million in new property tax revenue for next fiscal year. Sales tax, we're projecting a 5% growth in our sales tax revenue. That new sales tax dollars comes out to be a little over $1.3 million. Departmental revenue, these are the revenues that the county departments either generate themselves or funding they get from the state or federal government is passed through. Those funds are actually down $395,000. The majority of that is due to restricted funds from the state. We're not getting quite as much revenue from the state as we have in the past. And fund balance usage to balance the budget, I'm recommending that we appropriate a little over $6.6 million of our free and clear fund balance to balance the budget. We also have some fund balance that we use for the home care community block grant match for our outside agencies. That's typical, $240,000 used for grant matches for outside agencies. And then I'm recommending that we use a little over $606,000 from our designated fund. This is not our free and clear, as I like to call it. This is from designated funding. That's for economic development infrastructure and also for our former LME employees' retirement health insurance. So we'll talk a little bit further about property tax, what's going on with property tax next fiscal year. You can see that we're projecting a base value, our tax base value, of over $14 billion for Alamance County tax base. That's up approximately $365 million from this fiscal year. Our collection rate has gone from a 98.64% to 98.8%. That's good news. That will help us create additional property tax dollars. Thanks to Jeremy and the folks at Tax that worked very hard to make that happen. And our motor vehicle collection rate, now that the state is collecting that on our behalf, is at 99.9%. We're estimating that in fiscal year 18-19, the total revenue for property tax will be $78.9 million. Again, that is $2.2 million from property tax revenue. And 1 cent in this recommended budget equals $1,385,494. That's 1 cent on the property tax. Information about sales tax. This for 18-19, we're projecting $28.9 million in revenue from sales tax. That's up $1.3 million. That's a 5% increase. And I've put on this slide that over the past 5 years, we've experienced overall 6.9% increased growth. We had 2 years where the growth was very high, so we feel like 5% is a conservative estimate. I wouldn't be keen on going any higher than 5%. And then in this chart, you can see how that breaks down. Our sales tax comes in through three articles, which are state laws. And this chart shows you, some of our sales tax money is strictly for the county to use any purposes that it likes. And some is restricted for only for school use, and it must be used for capital. These are these funds I was talking about earlier. So gives you an idea of how the dollars are going to be. We foresee the dollars coming in next year in each one of these sales tax articles. A little information about fund balance. So for 18-19, I'm recommending that we use a little over $6.6 million to balance the budget. That's from our appropriated fund balance, our free and clear, as I call it. And that is down slightly from this fiscal year, only about $8,000. But this is an area of concern for me. This is the first time in 3 years that we've budgeted less fund balance to balance the budget than we have. I'd like to try to continue that trend. I think it's a wise idea. We're trying to safeguard our fund balance as we may be going into bonds. We're hoping to look at a credit rating upgrade, and fund balance is an important part of that. So we certainly don't want to use any more fund balance this year, and we're actually using a tiny bit less. For our designated fund balance, again, this is not the same as our appropriated. We are using a little bit more, about 14%, $76,000. Again, this is for economic development infrastructure projects that the board has approved, as well as the LME retirees. And this next chart gives you an idea of what our fund balance was, our unassigned, our free and clear fund balance from the fiscal year 16-17 audit. This was the last audit the county had completed. It was a little over $26.3 million in our unassigned fund balance. That's a percentage of expenditure of 18.3%. The board, if you remember, we have a policy that we're trying to hit 25%. That is our goal. And the chart on this slide gives you an idea of how we budgeted fund balance each year, all the way back to fiscal year 13-14. And then on the far right column, it shows you whether we've gained in fund balance or lost fund balance. You can see that we are projecting for this fiscal year, we're projecting to spend $2 million in fund balance. That's not a good place to be. I don't like being there. That is the reason why we have moved to budgeting that $1.8 million on the front end. We hope that at the end of 18-19, we'll not be in the same boat where we're actually spending fund balance.
So just to clarify, we budget using our fund balance to balance the budget.
Yes.
But we rarely use what we budgeted. In fact, sometimes most of the time we even add to the fund balance, even though we budgeted to spend some of the fund balance.
That's what that far right column is.
Right. Yes, that's correct. Exactly. And you could see the trend in 16-17, we were pretty close to spending fund balance. In fact, we had to transfer $1.5 million from that amount over into school sales tax. We broke even in 16-17. 17-18, we're going to spend some fund balance. And I think budgeting this $1.8 million up front for the schools is the way to go. And it keeps us on track to hopefully not spend fund balance. We do have some fee changes. I did not put the details of these fee changes on the slide. You can look in the big ordinance book that you have there, pages 4-6, if you're interested in seeing the details of what these fee changes are. Planning and the dental clinic have some fee changes. Recreation also does. The only one I do want to touch on is the landfill. So the landfill is, we are closing our construction, our C&D landfill sale. And the C&D landfill had charged $32 a ton. We're going to be putting all C&D material into the line sale. So our plan in the budget is to charge $38 per ton, which is what we charge everything else that goes into line. So we think this is better. We're running out of room to open more C&D sales. We've also run the numbers and determined that it's cost prohibitive to open a new sale. It's actually better for us to put the debris into the line sale. So this slide's a little tough to see here, but I think you'll be able to see it a little better on your handout. This gives you an idea of where our general fund revenues come from. The lion's share, 53%, is coming from property tax. So the majority of our revenue comes from property tax. It's about 19% comes from sales tax, and then there are sundry other sources where our revenue comes from. So I want to talk a little bit about our county department budgets and go over a little bit of information with you strictly about county departments. I'll talk a little about personnel, infrastructure, and our debt. So I'll talk a little about county department personnel requests. If you remember at the budget retreat, county departments requested 14 and a half new positions. All the positions that were requested are listed here on this slide and in your handout. We also had a request from the Veterans Services Department to reclassify their all three positions in Veterans Services. And we had a request from the Board of Elections to institute a new career ladder for the employees there. My recommended budget is only recommending 5 new positions, 1 for the Department of Inspections, and I'll explain both of these in a little bit more detail on the next slide, and then 4 positions for social services. Some details about these positions. The 1 new position for the Inspections Department will be a Code Inspector 3. Inspections is through the roof with the amount of work that they have. They are wide open, and they have an excellent turnaround time right now. For us to be able to continue to offer the turnaround time that we have for our developers and our builders, we need to hire another inspector. And in fact, the department is experiencing an uptick in revenue, and we're required by law to spend those revenues on the inspections department. So this is right in line with state law and our needs. And then for the social services positions, we're talking 4 positions for social services, a social worker supervisor 3, and then 3 social worker investigative assessment and treatment positions. Now these are, Susan has talked to the board about the crisis they're having in Child Protective Services, the number of calls that they receive, the number of cases that their workers are currently working. So we feel like, or I feel like this is a reasonable request to make and to accommodate. In fact, only 1 position of these 4 is going to be funded with new dollars. The other 3 are going to be funded by the department within their own operating budget. We've met with Susan and her finance staff, and they've assured us that they can manage their funds in such a way that we can add 4 positions, but really only put money in for 1. And even that 1 we're putting in for is reimbursed at a certain percentage, so we're not putting in the entire cost of that position either. So I want to talk a moment about county employee compensation and benefits. If you remember at the budget retreat, I talked to you about at that time we were looking at revenues, and we were really thinking we may only have enough revenue and enough capacity to give some form of increase to our emergency service workers. We've gone back and retooled that plan. We have a retention plan that we're proposing to put in place. So for 4 of our 9 top turnover positions, we've mapped out our top turnover positions in county government. The top 9, of the top 9, 4 are in emergency services. These are the 4 that you see here: Deputy 1, Detention 1, EMT paramedic, and telecommunicator. These positions are, in my opinion, they're at crisis mode with their turnover. They are turning people over left and right. I'm suggesting that we institute a 2% pay increase effective July 1st for all employees in these 4 positions. Each employee in these 4 positions would receive a pay increase of 2% as of July 1. For the rest of county government, for all rest of county employees, we would institute a merit plan. And you can see the cost there beside the retention plan, the $142,000. That's the cost to implement that 2% for the emergency service folks. Merit plan, the cost is $418,000. And what would happen in our merit plan? We haven't had merit in a very long time. But under the merit plan, employees could receive up to a 2% increase. They are not guaranteed any increase at all. They could receive up to 2%. I imagine this would go 0%, 1%, or 2%. But before any employee could be eligible for a pay increase under this plan, the department must complete at least 75% of the performance management goals from the year before. So what we would do is look and see, did the department hit 75% of their performance management goals successfully? If so, if the department made all of its goals, then the employees in the department would be eligible for a merit raise, and that would depend on the evaluation of the employee. So there's a 2-step piece to this plan. And then
so that $418,000 would—that's what you estimated would cost to do this plan for all employees.
That's correct.
And making some assumptions about how many would likely get 1%, and how many would get 2%, and how many would get 0.
So that's not just a given, definite number there. Then it's
no, $418,000 does not fund 2% for all employees.
Right. We
haven't done merit in a long time, so we're not exactly sure how many people will get no raises, how many people may get 1%, but we have tried to figure that in. So This is not the same as the cost of living. This is not across the board, and it will not be effective July 1. In order to help us save money for this plan, we're making it effective when the employee's anniversary is. So if your anniversary is in May, you would be if your department made its goals, then you would be evaluated in May, and you might be eligible for a raise.
So, but that evaluation is from the prior year, right?
Yes, it is. It's for the prior year, and the performance management goals are also for the prior year. So for the upcoming fiscal year, we'll be looking at how did departments do in 17-18. Did they meet 75% at least of their goals? If they did, then the employee will be reviewed on their anniversary date, and it will be for the past year's worth of service from the employee. So this is different for county government. Again, it does several things. One, it's about retaining good employees. And that's what we want to do. We want to retain good folks and reward them. And it also makes it affordable. It helps that we're going on anniversaries as opposed to July 1. But for these positions that are high turnover, they're really rolling through so fast, we feel like they need to get the increase up front. We also have information here about the county employee health insurance. I'm proposing to put an additional $744,000 in that fund. We checked that fund this morning. We remain $1.7 million in the hole. So this is, you know, last year we put about the same dollar amount. We are gaining on it. We were $2 million in the hole last year. We feel like we're gaining on this problem. Ideally, we're not in the hole at all. We will have some level of fund balance, but it's going to take quite some time for us to do that. Talk a little bit about equipment for county departments at the budget retreat. The equipment requests were for over $400,000. You can see them all on this slide. These are all the, under the budget retreat part, these are all the requests from the departments for different pieces of equipment. I'm recommending that we fund $45,000 worth of those requests. One is a tractor for the Parks Department at $33,000. And then the DSS Family Justice Center grant. This is actually a grant. It's $12,000. This is not county funds, so it will, in fact, go through. So really here, county dollar-wise, we're talking about $33,000 for equipment.
Brian, wasn't there a request for an ambulance?
Yes. In fact, we're at it with the
vehicles, okay.
Yes. So with again, vehicles for county departments at the retreat, we had over $755,000 worth of requests for vehicles. You can see all of them up there, and indeed, we did have a request for a new ambulance and a remount and a replacement medic unit for our EMS department. I'm recommending a total of a little over $527,000 for vehicles. Sheriff's Department, I'm recommending that we fund 9 vehicles from the budget. Then we will fund another 3 vehicles from performance management funds. This, you know, this year, we funded all 12 from performance management. So for 18-19, my recommendation is Sheriff's Department will still get 12 vehicles, 9 will come from the budget, 3 will come from performance management funds. Then for EMS, I'm recommending that we do not purchase the new ambulance this year. We do 2 remounts instead of a remount and a new ambulance, but we do replace the medic. So we did lose the new ambulance in this recommended budget. Library materials, at the retreat, the request was for $252,150. I'm recommending that we fund that at a $200,000 level. These are funds we use for books and all kinds of other materials for the library, so that is a reduction in our previous year's dollar amount. And then we had some other improvements that county departments requested, a little over $247,000. You can see the list from the budget retreat of all the projects that were requested. I'm recommending that we fund $54,000 worth of these. These are maintenance projects that departments have told our county maintenance department. These are all projects that are under $10,000. You know, we have a CIP plan I'll talk about in just a moment for projects over $10,000. These are smaller projects. List of them, they involve EMS and our courts primarily. So to talk a little bit about county government capital, for next fiscal year, 18-19, we are, in this budget, I'm recommending that we spend a total of $6.6 million on county capital. Of that, it's important to note that only $2.5 million of it is actually in your budget. That is, debt service is about $2.3 million on former county projects, ones that we have done in the past, and then $250,000 for new CIP capital projects around county government. There's another $4.1 million in the capital plan only. It is not in this budget. Those are the Diversion Center, the $1.2 million we'll be receiving from Cardinal, as well as $2.9 million for the new animal shelter. My understanding is the new animal shelter will come online next year. We'll have to pay this, but it is not in the budget yet. It's just in the capital plan. So for county government, what are we going to do with our $250,000 for county buildings? We have the projects laid out here for you to review. We're going to do a couple of roofs. Some HVAC work, new generators for our EMS substations. Also, one of the main projects is to do elevator repair in this building. We've had multiple problems with it. These funds, this capital needs other funds. These are not county tax dollars. These are not general fund monies. We have funding that we get from E911, from the cell phone tax. Our central communications department is proposing to use $129,000 of that for training software for CCOM employees. Those are not county dollars. And then for the landfill, landfill's an enterprise fund, as you well know. It's not county tax dollar funded. The landfill's requesting to spend $568,000. I'm recommending that they be allowed to do that. And it's for all of these projects that you see listed here for the landfill. Quickly to touch on our debt service. Our debt service for next fiscal year, our total outstanding principal will be a little over $53 million. And you can see in the chart how that breaks down for the county, for Alamance Portland School System, and for the community college. It's laid out there, bonds and installments. Our total payment next fiscal year will be a little over $9.8 million. As I said, that's up almost 3%. And you can see kind of how it lays out each agency, how much money we'll be spending to pay debt. And our legal debt margin is a little over $1 billion, which we are nowhere close to that at $53 million, even that we have a large capacity for debt. So for Alamance Burlington School System, you see that in this fiscal year, 17-18, we funded them a total of a little over $41.6 million. Their current expense was over $40 million, and we budgeted $1 million in capital outlay. So I'm recommending for this fiscal year that the total dollar amount for Alamance Burlington School System be $42,337,894. That's a current expense. Recommendation of $41.3 million for their current expense and $1 million for their outlay, again, as we have done this fiscal year. So the total recommended increase for Alamance Burlington School System in this budget is $655,987. I'll explain to the board how we arrived at that dollar amount. What we did is we looked at the percentage that Alamance Burlington School System is of overall county government budget, which is 28%. We're not recommending a tax increase this year. It's 58 cents. We looked at how much new revenue would that create. And then we said we would give 28% of the new property tax revenue to Alamance Burlington School System, as well as 28% of the sales tax growth. It's important to understand when it comes to the sales tax growth, the majority of that has to go into their capital. And we've accommodated that. I think it's roughly 25% of the new sales tax dollars for the school is in their capital. So about 3% of new sales tax growth total is going to the school system. But both of those add up to $655,987. And then for ABSS's capital plan, we're proposing in this recommended budget to spend almost $12 million on ABSS capital. $6 million of that is in the budget itself and the capital plan. 5.8 of it is in the capital plan only. But you can see how it breaks down here. Of that $6 million that's in the budget, $5 million of it is for debt service. And then $1 million of it is for their capital outlay. And you can see there under the capital plan, all the dollars, a lot of this has been talked about this evening, lottery fund, sales tax, capital reserve, that they have access to for their projects. So we'll talk a little bit about Alamance Community College. This fiscal year, the year that we're in, we funded them at a little over $3.6 million. I'm recommending that we fund the total recommendation of funding for Alamance Community College is $3,718,111. That's a total recommendation for their current expense at a little over $3.2 million, and we would remain at $440,000 for their capital outlay. That is a total recommended increase for Alamance Community College of $54,909. Method we use to arrive at this is similar to the method we use for Alamance Burlington School System. Alamance Community College is 2% of the county's overall budget. So we looked at allocating 2% of the property tax growth only to Alamance Community College, and that came up to be $54,909. Capital plan for ACC next fiscal year. The total amount we plan to spend on ACC capital is $2.9 million. Of that $2.9 million, $2.5 million is debt service for former projects for the college, and the $440,000 for capital outlay. Outside agency requests. At the budget retreat, we had a request totaling over $3.3 million. I'm recommending that we fund outside agencies at a total dollar amount of a little over $3.2 million. 12 outside agencies are going to receive county funds. As I explained to you earlier, we've held all outside agencies flat with the exception of that are receiving county funds for their operations, with the exception of ACTA. They're planning to receive $23,000 extra to help with their lease. and also the Forest Service with an extra $2,000. We do have five agencies that are occupancy tax funded, and I'm going to talk about that on the next slide. And then we have pass-through funding. This is state and federal money. This is not county dollars, to the dollar amount of a little over $1.6 million. We did have two outside agencies that requested funds that I'm recommending that we not fund. One step further, an exchange club's family center, and making sure everyone understands this has nothing to do with their mission or anything about those agencies. This was just such a tight budget that I felt like it would be very difficult for us to accommodate brand new requests into the county dollar part of the budget. So I'll go over the occupancy tax recommendation with you. We're projecting that occupancy tax in fiscal year 18-19 will be $819,690. The county share of those dollars will be $273,230. Two-thirds of, by law, by our local law, two-thirds of those dollars have to go to the Tourism Development Authority, the TDA, and that equals $546,460. So you can see the TDA gets their share. Then under the one-third county share column in the chart, you can see how we have broken up the requests for these the county share of funding. The African American Cultural Arts and Historic Center, $25,000. The Arts Association, which is the Arts Council, $80,000. Glencoe Textile Museum, $71,730. The Historic Museum, $84,000. And the Sword of Peace, $12,500. And again, these are occupancy tax dollars, not county general fund. So this chart gives you an idea of how the recommended budget spends the dollars. You can see that education receives a little over 30% of all county general fund dollars, followed by public safety at 23.6% and human services at 21.5%. And that education is Alamance Burlington School System and the community college put together.
Including capital.
It is including capital. It does not include their debt, just their capital and their operating.
You mean their debt service on debt that's already issued?
Like yes, it does not include that. That 30% doesn't include the debt service for that's already issued for those two entities. I am recommending a change to the ordinance. This is a little different this year. So I'm recommending that the commissioners give me the authority to execute extensions on master lease agreements. We have a number of lease agreements for particularly for IT projects, IT needs, leases, copiers, computers. Conferred with our IT department, our county attorney, recommendation is that instead of having to try to bring those to the board constantly, I would have the authority to sign them. This is new, and I want to make sure it was called to the attention of the board. Touch briefly on the volunteer fire departments. We have not had any volunteer fire department request a tax increase this year. So the total budget, the total dollars that would be budgeted for all volunteer fire departments next fiscal year is $5.3 million. So this concludes my presentation of information to you about the manager's recommended budget. Our next step will be June 4th. We'll have our planned public hearing at 7 o'clock at Cummings High School over in Burlington. And at that point, the public will be invited to come and comment. At this time, I'd be happy to entertain any questions about the recommended budget.
Had a lot of words there.
It's a lot to say, a lot of information to cover. Indeed.
Well, I'd like to make some comments. I don't know if I have. I think I understand the budget. So I think that our job is to make sure that our needs are being met in our community. And I don't like having to receive a budget that's based on an artificially set tax rate of 58 cents. And there's no doubt that you've done a good job at making sure that this budget is a bare bones budget and maybe a little bit too bare bones. So I've always said that I'm not opposed to a tax increase as long as possible expense cuts have been exhausted and other revenue sources have been exhausted. And as long as whatever we come up with a tax rate is reasonable and comparable to similar counties. So our 58 cent tax rate is the 28th lowest in the state. And I've said this many times, other people have said it too. And it's way lower than any other county that touches us. The next one that touches us, the next lowest is Chatham at 62.81 cents. And then it goes up from there. Randolph's 65 and a quarter. Rockingham, 69.6. Guilford, 73. Caswell, 74.59. Durham, 76.79. And Orange at 83.77. And I'm not suggesting we need to be equal to any of those, but I am suggesting that we need to meet our needs. The median tax rate, that, in case for those who don't know what median means, that means that's the rate in the middle, so that 50% of the counties have a higher tax rate and 50% have a lower tax rate. That median is right at 69 cents. That's 11 cents more than what our tax rate would be. And I'm really concerned about shortchanging our schools. So we were presented with an ABSS budget. I can't remember the exact numbers. I have it here. A pretty big increase of over $4 million, I believe it was.
Yes.
And $1.8 million of that was just to continue what they're doing now to pay for the inflationary things. And it included an assumption that the state was going to increase teacher salaries by 3%. The legislature might do more than that. But just for us, you know, we'd have to fund the teacher pay supplements of those positions. So a teacher gets a 10% supplement. Well, that dollar amount for 10% of the increased salary is going to go up. And we fund positions directly as well. And so we would have to cover those increases expenses. So just those things, without adding any more staff or anything, would be $1.8 million. And you're recommending, I forget what the dollar amount is, it's $600,000 or something?
$655,000.
So, you know, they're a custodial budget. And we hear complaints about our schools not being clean. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that the service that the ABSS board entered into was entered into at a time of real austerity during the recession. And it was all, you know, and they had an austere budget, but it wasn't getting the schools clean. And so this past year they did a pilot program in the Western Zone and found out, boy, this works a lot better, but it costs more money. And to do that for the rest of the district, so we just have adequate custodial services, is going to be another $1.3 million. And then they're asking for some teacher pay supplements, which, you know, our teachers, we lose teachers to neighboring counties because our supplements are less. And part of the strategic plan and the priority of the school board was to make sure that our teachers are being paid competitively. And this, that even that half cent that was being requested of an increase in pay supplement doesn't get us the full competitiveness to the counties around us. But that's a priority, because where the rubber hits the road in teaching our kids is with the teacher and the other staff associated with them. And there's some principals, assistant principals, and other staff too that needed to be funded. So to me, all these things are very important. And then there are some, and not big, huge dollars, but dollars for what is called in the strategic plan as special programming. And I can't tell you how important special programming is, but it costs some money. So my wife, Barbara, attended the Andrews Elementary School a little over a week ago. This is part of a United Way program for donors to see what some of the United Way donations were being used for. And she came away from that just absolutely flabbergasted. Now, this is a school that's almost all free and reduced lunch, mostly made up of people of color. And the Leader in Me program is, these kids from kindergarten up are dealing with being educated around and using this the book, you know, you've heard of the 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. And so each child adopts their favorite habit. And they're taught that they're so poised, and they're taught how to speak in public. Even kindergartens were speaking to this group of 40 or 50 people in just really great ways. And if you look at the statistics of that school, grades are up, attendance is up, parent engagement is up, discipline problems are down, and so this is really working. And there's all kinds of special programming that's going on throughout our schools. I mean, the A-plus
arts program in a couple of the elementary school, including North Graham Elementary. And Barbara and I went and saw the play Annie a couple of weeks ago. It was unbelievably good. It really was. And it involved kids from North Graham Elementary, Graham Middle School, and Graham High School. These kids, the choreography, the complex getting on and off the stage, and the dancing, and the singing, and everybody knew their lines. There's no hiccups. I mean, it was just fabulous, well coached. But this is what is the result of special programming. And you think of the other things going on around the system, like the International Baccalaureate Program at Williams, where any student in the district can go. And the global education program going on in some of the elementary schools. It's just one thing after another that is really producing results. And so built into this budget was just a little bit of expansion of that, a little bit more. And so all that, I don't understand. I mean, you just think that, okay, they really need $4 million, so let's give them $650,000 and let them figure it out. Well, that school system is as much our responsibility as any other department that we have in our county government. We are responsible for educating our kids, and we need to support our board. So let me just tell you, Saturday, my wife and I went to this wonderful program, the dedicating of one of the buildings in the school system in memory of Dr. William Shanks. Dr. Shanks was a black leader in this community, and more importantly, he was a leader for everybody in this community. I knew Dr. Shanks because he used to make rounds at the skilled nursing division of Memorial Hospital when I was the administrator there. Wonderful man, a real gentleman. And so at this event, so this was at Sellers, well, the building is at Sellers Gunn High School. The event was held at First Baptist Church, Apple Street. And they're naming what was the gymnasium as the Dr. W.C. Shanks Jr. Gymtorium. Just a wonderful program. So one of the speakers was Donna Oliver. Now, Donna Oliver was one of our teachers at the old Burlington school system. And she became North Carolina Teacher of the Year. And she went on to become National Teacher of the Year and was awarded that by our President of the United States. So she had some wonderful things to say. And she went on to be a college and university president. And now she's retired, living back here in Alamance County. Her daughter, whose name is Rachel Oliver Cobbin, turned out to be Miss Black America. I mean, a national contest. I mean, so these are some of the things that happen in our community. But in the tribute to Dr. Shanks not only was a great physician, but he was a community leader, and he served on the Burlington School Board for something like 24 years. And it was noted by several speakers at this event that the Burlington school system, this is before merger with Alamance, in Burlington school system, had a state reputation. And people would talk how they moved to Burlington because of the quality of the Burlington school system. And this is where they wanted to raise their family and bring their businesses. And that's exactly what's in our vision plan right now, is that ABSS will be so good that people will want to move here and bring their businesses here, and we'll attract and retain the best teachers because our school system is that good, and we support our teachers, not just with competitive compensation, but with respect and support. So I say this, Mr. Bob Poindexter was one of the speakers. I don't know if anybody remembers him. I just met him for the first time when I was putting out yard signs a few weeks ago, and he was across the street of a yard. I was putting a sign, and he wanted to talk. And he recognized me. But he was one of the presenters, and he talked about the reason why the Burlington school system was so good was because of the leadership that this community put forth with respect to the school board for the Burlington school system and the city council. Because back then, the local funding didn't come from the county for the Burlington schools, it came from the city council. And they knew how to invest and get a return on that investment and to show some leadership. And as far as Dr. Shanks goes, it was kind of funny. Mr. Poindexter said, Dr. Shanks, he carried a big voice, even though he was a very meek and mild man, but he carried the voice of four people on that seven-member board. And I'm thinking, boy, I sure do wish I could have a voice for three of our five-member board. No offense to my fellow colleagues here. But that's what it takes. It takes leadership to achieve results. And we're not in a period of austerity right now. And so why have a budget based on this artificial low tax rate during a time of prosperity? This is the time that we need to be investing in ourselves and investing in our future. We should want every child in this district to have the same opportunity to have a successful high school career and go on and get a really good job and be taxpayers and not be using tax dollars for support services because they didn't have a successful life. I mean, we need to be investing in our schools. And I'm thinking, okay, so what if we just had another 3 cents added to the tax rate? Now, I know we have school bonds coming up, and everybody's afraid, well, if we support operations right now, then we might sour the public's desire to vote in favor of the school bonds, which are entirely important. But just to put that into perspective, though, a 3 cent tax increase, and I did these numbers in my head before I realized that the each cent is worth it even a little more right now, but three cents is for the average person roughly has a $150,000 home. So 3 cents is $45 a year. That's $3.75 a month. And I just can't fathom, if we can't convince our constituents and our community that's not a good value when you're looking at what that money could go for with our schools. And this is targeted money, like I was saying. This is for teacher increases. It's for just maintaining the continuation of their budget with the inflationary costs that they have. And really, I think that the Board of Education scrutinizes. I mean, I go to all the meetings. Amy goes with me. She might have a different opinion. But I'm very comfortable that their budget is just as lean and mean as the budget that you're recommending to us. And there's just, and they have even less flexibility as to how they spend their money because it's so, the legislature requires, line item by line item in expenditure. So I don't know where you think that they're going to come up with money just to survive when it's, you're recommending so much less. And it's not just the schools, but it's our other departments too. And I mean, I'm really concerned that we're not doing something even more for our county employees. I mean, I applaud you for doing what you're doing with the merit. I think that's good, but we got to pay attention to make sure that we're keeping our good people. I mean, if I were working for this county, I think the air would be let out of my sails to know that this was the budget that was being recommended. And I think the same goes for our schools, our Board of Education. It's an insult to our youth and to our Board of Education and the taxpayers that elected our Board of Education and really to our department managers and to our staff and to the Board of ACC and Dr. Gatewood and his team and all the students that really need a good educational experience there. So I don't know. I'm glad that we have some time. I hope that people realize what's not in this budget, because I just think that we don't need to be penny wise and pound foolish. I wanted to say about the tax too. So even if we had a 3 cent tax increase and we go to the bonds and those pass, and hopefully the sales tax referendum would pass as well, because that would lower the necessary debt service from almost 8 cents. It would lower it by 3.6 cents just by using the proceeds from that quarter cent tax rate. And so what's 8 minus 3.6? It's 4.4. So that's a four, even, and there's still opportunities to get it down to 1.9. That's very possible. But even at 4.4 plus the three that we're doing now, that's 7.4. We're still, really good shape compared to similar counties and all the counties around us and the counties across the state. I mean, what? Why not invest in ourselves? That's what I think. And that tax rate, that the mentality of just keeping the tax rate as low as possible, no matter what, it's impeding progress for this community. And that's the way I feel.
Let me say, this Bob has wasted everybody's time here tonight with his liberals, whatever he talks. He's a talker. This board is made up of five people. You are one of the five, and you're the most liberal person on here, and Alamance County can't afford people like you being in office. And I hope that the people will put you out of office in November. We don't need a tax spend. I'm tired of listening to you.
I'm going to be in Bob's camp here a little bit, because when I ran on my election, I was going in on education, one of our pillars, world-class education. And I told you the other day I was disappointed what we did with the schools. We do have a public hearing coming in June, and we'll hear what the county wants.
We'll hear what part of the county wants. The election is what the county wants. When we have an election,
yeah, okay.
It's what the people want and what they're willing to afford.
That's true. You will hear it then, but we've got a choice to make this June.
That's exactly right.
And we'll see what the people
absolutely
want.
Well, I will say that, Mr. Lashley, I don't share your estimation of Mr. Byrd. I think he's a fine person. And
I think he's a fine person, too, but he's a liberal.
He has
wasted taxpayers' money.
He may have a different outlook on politics and certain things than I do, but I do respect him, and I respect the sincerity and his comments are well-grounded and based in fact and well-researched. I think that it's important to remember that just as the county, Mr. Haygood has done an outstanding job of bringing forward a budget this year. It's very difficult to do. He and his staff have done that. Just as the county is making difficult choices between things to fund, when we increase people's cost of living, that passes a burden onto them. And that is significant to me. Just like we have to make decisions between an ambulance mount and library books and funding the Alamance Community College, which is a dear and important part of our community and extremely valued and cherished. Just like we have to make difficult decisions about that, we have people in our community who have to choose between electricity and rent or medicine or food. So it's a complicated situation. And I appreciate, Mr. Lashley, I appreciate your passion, and I appreciate Mr. Byrd's passion, and I think that's what
America's all about. I got one more comment, if you don't mind.
Of course.
Working in real estate in the county, we have realtors realize the importance of our schools. In fact, when I show houses or people come here looking for homes and other realtors, they don't ask what our tax rate is. They ask, how are your schools? And the reason they ask that, because they're going to put their children in the best schools they can. And if it means staying in a county that has a higher tax rate to get a quality education for their children, in the long run, that's a heck of a lot better investment than it is to come into a lower tax rate because of us being conservative, which is fine. Conservative and spending your money wisely don't necessarily go against each other. I mean, if you spend your money wisely, and I think the county has spoke, and we will find out in November how they really feel about education in this county. And I'm still just disappointed in what we've done with the schools. And
rate would you like to see, Eddie?
I think we could add a penny and a half and take care of part of those two needs.
Well, that's the way, that's why we have this meeting.
That's it.
Mr. Boswell, I've talked to people who've moved here from other places, and a lot of them are older people who came here because of the low tax rate. I mean, that's just true. Also talked to a lady.
Are you selling property? You're not selling property in this county.
No, of course I'm not selling. Okay. I am not selling property. I don't represent that I am, but I am talking to people who have moved here from other places.
Well, talk to the realtors. They went on a bus trip last week to look at our schools.
Well, I don't also I don't dispute or deny that the quality of the school system is extremely important.
It is.
In
very
the health
important.
And vitality of the community. Yeah. But it's a complicated soup, and I talked to a lady who moved here from another county with higher taxes, and she moved here with her children for lower taxes, and she did. And then she ended up paying what she would have saved on taxes. She ended up paying in a higher water rate for where she
there
moved to. So it's a complicated.
It is complicated.
Things.
The answer is not always to raise taxes. That is not the answer. You can get a good school system with good teachers. We have a good school system. But the people can't go bankrupt supporting them and paying for the cost. It's just that simple.
Well, we'll
decide in June.
That's right.
Well, thank you very much, Commissioners. Thank you.
Well, I have one more thing to say. I think sure. I think it's important to take the long view, and that if these bonds pass, and I do support the bonds, if they do pass, then we're going to have people taking a hit to their household pocketbook, and I just question whether or not this is the year to push that. When we need the need for extra capacity in our school system is quite dramatic. So, thank you so much, Mr. Haygood, and
good
we
job,
will
Brian.
Have the public hearing on June 4th at 7 p.m. at Cummings.
That's correct. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, we do have a social services budget amendment, and here comes. Our director.
Good evening.
Running.
Good evening. Yes, I'll be very quick. So we get allocations throughout the year, and we get new spending amounts. So this just trues up what we've gotten. Revenues equal expenditures and appropriations. So this is no additional county money, just making our books match with our final allocations from the state. I'll be glad to answer any questions.
I make a motion that we approve.
Second.
All right, thank you. We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
All right, Mr. Haygood, do you have a report for us tonight?
I do have one item for your consideration, Commissioners. I spoke with Mr. Doug Fincannon today, and Mr. Fincannon is the Commissioner's appointee to the Board of Trustees for Alamance Community College. Mr. Fincannon does not plan to seek reappointment for the Board of Trustees. So I'd like to suggest to the Commissioners that we go ahead and post that the county's taken applications for this appointment position, this board appointment position to the Board of Trustees. If we post now, we can run information on our website that we'll be accepting applications through the month of June. Then at the July 16th meeting, we could bring you those lists and we'll provide them to you beforehand so you can make a decision at the July 16th meeting who you would like to appoint. That way the new appointee to the Board of Trustees would be ready for the Community College Board meeting on August 13th. So if that sounds reasonable to the Commissioners, that's the way that we will go. So.
Okay. Thank you. Right.
And that's all that I have.
Okay. Do we have any Commissioners' comments?
No. I've said enough.
We've talked enough, right?
Here. Yeah, and Bob's said enough for all of us. But go ahead, Bob.
Well, it's a good thing I didn't have anything more to say.
No, I'm teasing. Go ahead.
Well, I did attend, in addition to attending Dr. Shanks's ceremony, I attended a really, really nice event that commemorated the killing of a young African-American man during the race riots of 1969 in Burlington. I just think it's really important to understand our African-American history and some of the things that were going on during this time so that they don't get repeated. It was real enlightening to me, and Chief Smythe from the Burlington Police Department was there, and a couple of other dignitaries, and so I was real happy to be there as well. And that's all I want to say about that for now. Thank you.
Okay. Is there any other business before the board? If not, then we'll be adjourned.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.